Media studies is a really significant subject as it helps to highlight issues of race and identity. Our students are able to develop an awareness of the representations of Black people across a range of media products such as newspapers, magazines, TV, film, advertising and music video. The subject has and always will be relevant as long as issues of race and stereotyping, among others, are prevalent in post-colonial Britain. What messages do we receive from the media which help us to shape our ideological viewpoints? Through critical thinking and analysis, students are able to form their own opinions and meaning by studying some academic theory, including celebrated Black academics such as Stuart Hall, bell hooks, and Paul Gilroy.
One of the ways that psychology has tried to tackle racism is to consider cultural bias within psychology. So what we mean when we're talking about cultural bias in psychology is the tendency that we all sometimes have to judge anyone in terms of our own cultural assumptions, to take what we think we know about the world and to think that we can just apply it to other people and that it will relate to their experience of the world. As part of the psychology specification, we encourage students to challenge any theory that they come across and think about whether it might be guilty of cultural bias. Is this theory trying to judge all people using the same measure? Now, we know that most psychology, so that's theories and research, has been written by Western psychologists. So that's people in Europe, that's people in America, and then it's tested on Western participants. This means that these theories kind of inherently are culturally biased, that they've been made in one area of the world and then they've been tested in that area of the world. And then sometimes they're applied to other areas as though these are appropriate measures for phenomena that's happening in those parts of the world. A great example of this in psychology was a way of measuring the attachment between children and caregivers. Ainsworth and Bell came up with something called the strange situation classification, and they wanted to measure how well children were attached to their caregiver. So attachments could vary from a strong and secure attachment to an insecure attachment. And the suggestion from Ainsworth and Bell was that using their method, they could judge the quality of an attachment. And they were looking for things like the responsiveness of the caregiver. They were interested in things like whether the child was distressed if their parent left the room. And what they concluded was that a parent who is responsive to their child's needs, who sensitively responds, so that means they interpret the signals that their children gives, is likely to be a parent who has a secure attachment with their child. But what this doesn't acknowledge is differences in parenting practices. In some cultures, children are encouraged to depend upon their parents and to look to their parents for guidance. In other cultures, children are encouraged to be independent. And Ainsworth and Bell didn't consider that when they came up with this classification. They assumed that what they saw in the West was a good way of judging the quality of a relationship between a parent and their child. And this, unsurprisingly, had big implications. This theory was taken and then it was used to judge attachments outside of the West. And quite significantly, it was used to judge the quality of parenting in Australia. And one of the consequences of this was that Indigenous Australians had their children removed from them because their relationship with their children was judged as insecure, and their children were put in foster homes or they were adopted. As you can see from this article, the Australian government has since apologised for this practice, but this is obviously too late for all of those families. And it's why today so much psychology encourages debate and discussion. Is there cultural bias? And if there is cultural bias, how can we eradicate it from this science? One of the ways that psychologists are trying to do this is to encourage Indigenous theories. These are theories that are embedded in the culture for which they're going to be applied. I think this is a really good example of how psychology tries to be anti-racist.
Chemistry is anti-racist because collaboration is essential to chemistry. Whether this be through the practice of early chemistry in the Islamic medieval world, Mary Daly, the first US African American woman to receive a PhD in chemistry, or Akira Yoshida, the current Nobel laureate in chemistry for his work on lithium-ion batteries. Progress in chemistry and society can only happen through a diverse global chemistry community.
Black lives matter in geography because they've shaped the areas in which we live and work in, both historically and today.
Just one example of this is Windrush Square in Brixton, which was renamed to recognise the important contribution of the African Caribbean community to the area. The organisation Black Cultural Archives is also located here.
As well as historical influences, black-owned businesses continue to shape London's culture today, and this is just a tiny selection of some of those.
Globally, black geographers and environmentalists shape our understanding of the world. Wangari Maathai founded the Green Belt Movement and became the first African woman to receive the Nobel Peace Prize for her work in 2004.
Christopher Jackson is a lecturer of earth science at Imperial College. He's also featured on the TV programme Expedition Volcano.
Clyde Woods not only sought to focus attention on the plight of poor communities of colour, but he also actively encouraged and mentored black geographers in order to diversify the discipline.
Leah Namagoa is a 15-year-old activist campaigning for climate justice in Uganda.
Isra Hersey is the 16-year-old co-founder and executive director of US Youth Climate Strike. The daughter of a Somali-American refugee, Hersey feels strongly about making room for more Muslim and black youth to be leaders in the climate movement. Creating more space for those with marginalised identities in the climate space is necessary for inclusive solutions.
It's important to recognise that geography has a long and complicated history in relation to racial oppression, and that black geographers are underrepresented. We as geographers need to ensure that it becomes a more inclusive and diverse subject in the future. This will require more than words. It requires evaluating, generating, and transforming how we work.
Anti-racist education is important in religious studies because our students develop informed opinions and the chance to consider wisdom and ideas from different religions and worldviews. For example, a Christian can argue that they are anti-racist because they believe each human being is made in God's image and likeness. This implies that racial injustice is a denial of the image of God. Furthermore, a humanist would challenge themselves to deconstruct systematic racial privilege so we can all benefit from a more empowering, multicultural perspective that honours the inherent worth of all. Likewise, a Muslim will say that they are anti-racist and are taught to believe, as described in the Prophet Muhammad's, peace be upon him's, last speech, that all mankind is from Adam and Eve. An Arab has no superiority over a non-Arab, nor a non-Arab has any superiority over an Arab. Also, a white has no superiority over a black person, nor a black has any superiority over a white person, except by piety and good action.
In trying to understand how society works, sociologists have always looked at the groups that make up any society, and they have always chosen to avoid the word race in favour of ethnicity. Sociologists tend to favour a nurture over a nature argument. Rather than seeing race as something that is physiological, sociologists are interested in ethnicity, the cultural differences that are socially constructed that can lead to differences in the outcomes of individuals from different ethnic groups. This means that the discussions in the media that there have been around statistics surrounding school performance, statistics surrounding imprisonment, statistics surrounding stop and search, are areas that sociologists have always been interested in. Why is it that some groups appear more in these statistics than others? And often they appear in them in quite negative ways. We often talk about the underachievement of some ethnic groups. We talk about the overrepresentation of some groups in the prison population. And so sociology has always been interested in talking about ethnicity. But I think in the context of what we are seeing in the news at the moment, the beauty of sociology is the desire to try and explain why these statistics exist. Not to accept them, not to necessarily even ignore them, but to challenge them. Where do these statistics come from? Who collects them? How are they gathered? And most importantly, if we know what these statistics tell us, particularly if we're looking at national statistics, what can we learn from them? How can we explain the trends that we are seeing? Because only if we understand where these statistics come from and we can look at different explanations for them, can we begin to think about how we can change society for the better. And I think that is the job of sociologists.
Maths is anti-racist when data is used to support civil rights. Statistics might seem like objective facts, but they're open to bias. The mathematicians who create them have to decide which data to collect, which data is most important, and how all of the pieces are going to fit together. And these calculations are used to decide who gets a loan to start a new business or to buy their house. They can change people's lives. This is why mathematicians who are anti-racist are activists. They make sure that the data collected reflects the lives and prioritizes the lives of people of color. They create mathematical models that can identify trends and help optimize solutions to the problems of institutional racism. And essentially, mathematicians who are able to communicate these findings to people in power are essential advocates for change.
DT is anti-racist because without the inventors like Henry Sampson, John L. Love, and John W. Reed, the world would look so different. These inventors created inventions that helped to aid designers from all different paths and to bring their designs to life, making sure their dreams came true. Famous fashion designer Bethany Henderson once said, "Only when you know who you are will you be able to find the courage to do what drives you." What all these people have in common is not only the colour of their skin, but they teach us that you shouldn't let anyone stop you from creating what you believe in. And DT is for everyone who has a dream Mommy. And has a courage to follow that dream.
Being women, and even more so being black women, made it hard to forge a career in the space industry in the 50s and 60s. The recent SpaceX launch registered our interest in space travel and remind me of many black women who worked for NASA and many contributions they made. Katherine Johnson, a mathematician, Mary Jackson, an engineer, Dorothy Vaughan, a mathematician and also known as Human Computer, were among them. Their lives and work during space race in the 60s were very inspirational and beyond belief. If you want to know more about them, you can watch the film called Hidden Figures or read the book with the same name. Thank you.
Sports studies is anti-racist as we look at a number of sports initiatives which help combat discrimination. One of these is Kick It Out, which is an anti-racism initiative to help combat discrimination in football. You can find more at www.kickitout.org. PE is anti-racist as we educate students to break down barriers in sport. We focus on different sporting values such as respect, inclusion and fair play.
Morning girls. The Black Lives Matter movement has really inspired me to have a think about the drama curriculum at Burntwood and to think about introducing some more black writers into our curriculum. I started with Yasmina Reza. She wrote a play called Art. Then I moved on to Selena Thompson, who has written this brilliant monologue called Salt. That's another one. I also found this one, which is called Shoot to Win, and it is about a netball team, a black netball team, and what goes on in their dressing room. It's very good, very funny. Another play for the older students is called A Kind of People by Gurpreet Kaur Bharti. Very, very funny, very, very great writing. And then this play. This play is called Slavery. And in the 1930s, the US government realised that we were losing the voices of slaves, of people who were born into slavery. So they interviewed hundreds of the last of the slaves. And this writer, Jonathan Payne, has collected those writings, those interviews, and has turned it into a beautiful play with songs that slaves sung, etc. I've actually made contact with Jonathan, and he's a really lovely guy, and he has promised that he will come into Burntwood, that he will do some workshops and work with some of our young people. So that's very exciting.
Hi all. We've been thinking a lot recently about what it means to be anti-racist, what it means for Black Lives Matters. And I just thought I'd share that in CPLD, Children's Play, Learning and Development, and in Health and Social Care, it's about the individual. It's at the core of everything we stand for, is that we are caring for children of any race, any ethnicity, any cultural background. And with Health and Social Care, we are caring for the person. It doesn't matter what they look like on the outside, because they are people and they are in need of our care and our help and our support. And so, you know, everything that we stand for when we're thinking about those subjects is about the individual, not about their differences, but about how we're the same and how we need to care for each other. Okay, thank you.
English is anti-racist because we have so much diversity of literature in this country, and we see it as our responsibility to amplify as many different voices from as many different cultures as possible. For too long, if we think about English in the classics, we associate it with quite often dead white men, and we need to change that. In English, we not only want to reflect the diversity of the Burntwood community, but also the UK as a whole, through writers such as Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie, Adeline Yama, Maya Angelou, and Benjamin Zephaniah. We've also had writers such as Akala and Malaika Booker come in and work with our students in poetry workshops, which they've got so much out of. In English, we also want to ensure that we're keeping up to date and finding resources, old and new, which inform the impact of racism in society and how it is still having a detrimental effect on the deprivileged now. We also want to ensure that we are aware of the repercussions of our colonial past and the impact that has on writers and what they write about. For example, at A-level we teach Dracula, and the way that Bram Stoker depicts Dracula as this foreign outsider really sort of pertains to the fear of the Victorian reader of foreigners and outsiders coming over, when ironically this was at the peak of the British Empire and we were invading swathes of countries around the world. Andrew Levy once said that literature is the most fantastic piece of communication. So it's our responsibility to ensure that as many different voices from different cultures are represented. Recent world events give us hope that things are going to change, and we need to start with that change with our families, with our school, and with our community.
In light of the current Black Lives Matter protests in languages, we've been looking at the contribution that we can make towards anti-racism. And obviously, there's the message about tolerance and learning about others. But there's also the fact that we're going to be acknowledging a lot more as we go forward, facts like the fact that 50% of French speakers in the world live in Africa, and that there is a growing Black Latin American Spanish-speaking community in South America whose contribution to the French and Spanish speaking worlds we will be celebrating as well. Some examples of people from these communities who are French and Spanish speaking are people like Alexandre Dumas, the 19th century writer, very well known for writing the original of The Three Musketeers or The Count of Monte Cristo. There's also Josephine Baker, who was an entertainer, but then got involved in the resistance movement of the Second World War when the Germans had occupied France, a core theme of our study at A-level, and also then the civil rights movement after the war. And also in more modern day, Christiane Taubira, a politician who was really heavily involved in the campaign for same-sex marriage in France, and also has supported a lot the idea of land reform within the French Caribbean as compensation for, say, slavery, and has been a really important voice on that for the Black communities in France. In the Spanish-speaking world, a notable figure is Victor Cruz, who is a Puerto Rican-American football player, who is very proud and outspoken about his Spanish-speaking heritage, as well as being an African-American, and the role that that dual heritage plays in his career and in his life, and being a good influence on other young men from his background. So look out for more famous Black figures from the French and Spanish speaking world as the year progresses. And
Roman civilization was far from perfect, but one thing the Romans didn't do was to judge people by the colour of their skin. People from Africa first made a contribution to Britain nearly 2,000 years ago. In the 2nd century AD, a cohort of soldiers from Africa was sent to Hadrian's Wall to guard the Roman Empire's northern frontier. They brought their families with them and settled in Romano-British towns like York. The evidence tells us that when Britain was part of the Roman Empire, 10% of York's population was from Africa, which is a higher percentage than it is now. Watch this excellent documentary to find out more.
Computer science, we recognise the importance of being anti-racist. We recognise the significant contribution of Katherine Johnson, Mary Jackson and Dorothy Vaughan, who played a pivotal role in kicking off the space age because of their calculations that allowed computer scientists to compute the trajectories of spacecraft and their launch windows. We recognise the groundbreaking contribution of Mark Dean, who helped create the first personal computers at IBM, creating the architecture that allowed peripherals like keyboards, printers, and mice to be connected to the motherboard. We recognize the revolutionary handiwork of Gladys West, whose work on satellite positioning accuracy algorithms underpins all modern satellite navigation technology and location-aware service apps that we rely on today. She also worked on the first sea observation satellite, which has become vital in understanding climate change. These are just a few examples of the many people that have contributed to computer science and continue to do so, but would not have done so if they had succumbed in the battle against racist stereotypes.